So the next talk will be by Stefan Stoltz. He'll be presenting the paper Teaching Automated Theorem Proving by Example in PyRes 1.2.
Yes, this is about a relatively new prover I've written together with Adam Pease from Articulate Software. And because jokes are always better if they are explained, that snake is a Python. So what is this new prover all about? I teach logic to our first year students, and I teach it as it has always been taught in a relatively theoretical sense. So I tell them about syntax and semantics and inference systems, and at the end of the course, if I'm lucky, some of them can scholarize away an existential quantifier. Some of them can unify two terms if they're not too deep. And some of them can even perform a resolution step between two clauses. But none of them have any idea of how to actually implement that in running, working computer code. And then I get some of the crazy ones again at the end of the third semester for a half-year student project. And I show them the code of E. And that has not been a big success, I have to say, because it takes them about half a year to understand the code and leaves them about no time to do their project. Because our good high-performance theorem provers are quite complex, and they are also normally quite heavily, well, let's say, over-engineered, but at least engineered. They use algorithms for corner cases to make things faster, to make things better. They use all the tricks that the calculus allows for, and some that it doesn't, in the hopes that nobody notices. So these are quite complex systems. And basically, they come in two varieties. They come in, you have to write, you have to like assembler and work with pointers, as the C or C++ family, or they come in languages that our students, at least, are not usually familiar with, like OCaml, Haskell, Prolog, and Lisp, all languages I like, but all languages that our students often shy away from because they learn C, Java, and 15 different variants of JavaScript. And some of them teach themselves Python for fun. So what we want to achieve is to bridge that gap between theory and practice by offering a theorem prover that's written in a way that's easy to understand, but that follows like mainstream ideas, not super exotic. It uses a popular calculus, and it's very, very commented and very clearly written. And this prover, the resulting prover that we built, is something we now call PyRes. PyRes is really a fully automated theorem prover for full first order logic with equality. And to prove that, we put it into the CASP competition, where it came in last year with 7 problems, and I think it came in last this year with 26 problems, but it can do that. It can try them all. It doesn't fail. It has support. It has all the tools it needs. It's just very slow and bad. So we just picked the standard resolution calculus, basically what's in Robinson's 1965 paper, with subsumption and topology deletion for simplification techniques. We run a basic given clause algorithm, and I'm very happy that we just heard about that with the iProver talk. So we have a set of unprocessed clauses. We process them one at a time, and every time we process one, we perform all inferences that involve this clause and all previously processed clauses. Yeah, we've written this tool. Actually, we've written it in Python 2, but it's been up-converted to Python 3 about a year and a half ago. And this is really a very interesting language for this purpose. It's a very popular language with students. It's something they use a lot for the data science machine learning classes. It's generally easy to read. And what I like a lot, it really is Lisp in disguise. So you have S expressions and lambdas, and you also have lots of very high-level built-in data types. The lists are quite efficient. You have dictionaries that are very fast. You have real sets as a data structure. So that made it very easy to write a prover that uses explicit coding style, so everything is upfront, but still is very close to the theory. And to make it even easier to understand, we didn't just build one prover, we built three. We built the smallest prover you can build, essentially, well, not in Python under the assumptions we've made, that just reads a set of clauses and refutes them. It has no heuristics, it has no simplification techniques, it has no refined calculus options. It just picks a clause, builds all the factors, builds all the resolvents, and throws it into the unprocessed set. And that is just processed first in, first out. So just purely 100% picks the oldest clause first. And that's a very weak prover, but it works. And it can solve, for example, pass 001-1 from TPTP. The second version is that we take that minimal prover and we add to it some things to make performance better. We put in subsumption, we put in topology deletion, we put in indexing, we put in negative literal selection as a calculus refinement, and we put in fairly good heuristics, well, simple heuristics, but a good scheme like an E for picking the given clause. So you can have an arbitrary number of weighted Qs based on age or symbol counting, and you pick from them in turn. And the third version is just the second version with an added clausifier in front. So you can process full first order logic and also equality, because that prover also will detect equality and just add all the proper axioms to the axiomatization. So there's no support for equality at the calculus level, just do it in pre-processing, which of course also makes it very weak, but it allows us to process problems with equality and be sound and complete on them. Here's an example of the coding style. This is the simple proof state class, or at least a small part of it. And we see the constructor in Python that just gets a set of clauses. And all it does is it creates two internal sets of clauses, unprocessed and processed. And it puts all the clauses that it was given in the constructor into the unprocessed set. And then you have a proof set that you can use. And what you normally do next is you call the function saturate. And saturate will just, as long as there is something in unprocessed, process the next clause. And if that returns the empty clause, hooray, we've won. If not, go on. And of course, eventually, this is Python style. If the loop is empty, we also return none, because that means we've saturated the set without finding the empty clause. The set is satisfiable. And you can see this is actually, we have a slightly different piece of code in the paper. And one of the referees said, in your pseudo code, why do you use these funny names? And the reason is the funny names you use are actually functions from the Python standard library. And it's not pseudo code, it's executable code. It just looks a lot like pseudo code because Python is such a nice language if you don't mishandle it too much. Okay. I think Einstein said you should make things as simple as possible, but not simpler. And so on the left-hand side, we have the features of PyRes. We can process all the classical TPTP, FOF, and CNF languages. We have a clausifier. We have equality handling. We have subsumption, forward and backward. We have simple but efficient indices for resolution and subsumption. We have 4 or 5 different heuristics we can combine for clause selection. We have 3 or 4 different literal selection strategies. The prover does actually construct TSTP proof objects on the fly and can spit them out, and they look just like, well, a little bit nicer than ETH, I would say, because there's not so much rewriting involved. And it has a full unit testing framework and achieves over 95% of coverage in unit tests. And those 5% are mostly the main programs, which are not units, so they can't be tested with a unit test. And if you compare E and PyRes, you can see that just by new lines, total lines in the code base, E is about 50 times larger. If you just look at the actual code, so no comments, no doc strings, and so on, it's even worse. And even if we take out the generated code, still the case that E, the handwritten code of E, is about 20 times bigger than the handwritten code in Pyrus. And in Pyrus, half of that is unit tests, so really productive code, it's 40 times smaller than E. And that means it's much, much easier to actually understand the prover. So what can it do? We've done some experiments on TPTP 7.2.0. And I have to thank Jeff for making StyleStack Miami available for these test runs. And we found reasonably good strategies for Pyrus. So that's clause selection. If many of you will know what this is, a la Larry Wass. The optimal pick given ratio is 5:1. So you pick 5 times the smallest clause and 1 times the oldest clause. We always select the largest negative literal for inferences if there is a negative literal. We enable both forward and backward subsumption. And we do use indexing. All of these features can be enabled and disabled, of course, in the prover. And if you look at the results, you can see that Pyrus can solve about 3,400 problems in TPTP. And many things we have learned for real high performance improvers also hold for Pyrus. So if you disable indexing, the prover is about half as fast. But this speed difference only costs us 90 problems, so a very small number. On the other hand, if we disable subsumption, we lose 2/3 of the performance, more or less. And what I didn't know beforehand, because I never thought about it or tried it, we can independently disable forward and backward subsumption. And it turns out that disabling backward subsumption doesn't make a huge difference. If you do forward subsumption only, we get nearly all the benefit. Backward subsumption on its own gives us very little benefit. And for people who like calculi, if we disable literal selection, we lose, again, nearly 1/3 over 1,000 problems. If you compare that to other state-of-the-art or standard provers, you'll see E can solve about 3 times more problems than Pyrus. And Prover 9, Bill McCune's successor to Otter, the standard in all CUST competitions, can solve a little bit less than 2 times as many problems. And what's interesting is if we look at this data in some more detail, this is the data adjusted on the other slide. But now we have it split by unit equality, clause normal form without equality, clause normal form with equality, full first order without equality, full first order with equality. So the yellow ones are with equality and the orange ones are without equality. And you can see UEQ factor of 7, no equality factor of 2. Clauses with equality, factor of 5. No equality, factor of 2. First order with equality, again, factor of 4 to 5. And if you look at prover 9, for comparison, you can see the same thing. The prover Pyrus is really weak on problems with equality, but it's not too bad on problems without equality. For example, it's nearly as good as LeanCorp on these. And it's only a factor of 2 worse than the high-performance provers, which I found quite surprising given that it's so simple. Okay, future work. Really, none. I had a lot of fun hacking the prover. It's so easy compared to E. You have such a high level of language and you don't care about performance. You can just write code and it works. It's fantastic. But we don't really want to increase the size of the code base very much. Of course, the obvious next step would be to do something about equality, and equality is complex, so it would easily double the size of the code base, something we don't want. On the other hand, there are some things we do want to do. Especially Adam is very eager to do a second implementation of the same ideas in Java. Java is another language often used in teaching, and he wants to be able to have a nice, clean Java prover that he can use and show off. Some things we might do is to add things that are clearly separate from the main core, like axiom selection or new heuristics. And something completely different, not involved with code at all. You can do things like a Pyrex hacking competition where students get, say, a day or two to improve the prover and then run a competition. We can have individual student projects just for learning, extend the prover in a certain way. And we have planned on writing a book to explain the prover, but that's something that has been pending for a long time, and I don't know if it will ever finish. So let me conclude. Pyrex is a fully functional theorem prover. It is simple, but it is quite feature complete. In particular, it has proof objects. It has indexing, as you can see how to integrate indexing with your prover. It has search heuristics that can be easily hacked. And it's quite easy to read. And actually, given that it's Python, the source code has to be available, but it's also free software. So you can download it from GitHub, clone it, and play with it. Everybody's welcome to do that. And all I can say is thank you for your attention. And are there any questions?
All right. Thanks, Stefan. So I believe Giles has his hand raised here.
Thank you very much for that very interesting talk, Stefan. I was just wondering if you have any, this tool looks like it would fit very well into an undergraduate course that I teach. I was wondering if you have any experience or materials. I mean, do you use it within the course that you teach?
Not yet. My experience is I've given it to some students and they said, it's much better than all the paper to understand what is going on. So the students I gave Pyrex were able to hack E after maybe a month and not after maybe 3 months. Mm-hmm. Because they see the analogy. They see it's the same given clause loop, the same invariance, even if the code is more complex and deeper, but the same ideas are there, and the ideas are much easier to get from this version.
Okay. I might take this conversation offline.
Might build a course around it. We have elective courses in the fifth and sixth semester for a bachelor, where I might do a course on, say, practical theorem proving to actually teach them how to do things, not just how to pretend to do things.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.